How's it going, ladies? My name is Costanza. I'm a STEM girly, but I also love the classics. They're a huge part of my formative years, and some of the translations in this video are mine, so if you make fun of them, I will engage in sexual intercourse with your father. Welcome to a series of videos about physics in the classical world. My mission is to take the classics from fascists and give them back to who they rightfully belong. Homosexuals. The so-called classical atomists were a group of philosophers alive from the 5th to the 3rd century BCE. And yes, we're using BCE because I grew up Catholic, so God and I have personal beef.
This was a long-standing school of thought with many philosophers. The ones we're gonna focus on today are Leucippus, Democritus, and the most famous of all, Epicurus.
But before we get to the atomists' theories, we have to understand what philosophical context they were operating in. You see, in the ancient world, there was a very famous and influential philosopher called Parmenides, who was fucking incomprehensible, oh my god. In his poem On Nature, he famously said,
"It is necessary to both say and think that being is. Indeed, being is, but nothing is not. These things I order you to consider."
Bro, what the fuck does this mean? Are you high? I'm translating it as being, but it literally means the concept of existing. The best translation is probably that which is. It's pretty much as abstract as it can get. And obviously there's more to Parmenides' philosophy, but since we only have a few fragments left from him, it's very difficult to truly understand what the fuck he was on about. Also, every single ancient philosopher had a poem called On Nature. Like, y'all thought of literally the origin of the universe, but you couldn't come up with something a little bit more original than Perifusios. The philosophy of Parmenides was all about unity. His main idea was that everything in the world, everything that is, everything that we see, everything that we could even possibly think about is part of the same fundamental substance, of the same that which is. And this that which is unchanging, eternal, and also perfectly spherical, because one thing about the Greeks, they love a good circle. And because everything is made of the same substance, according to Parmenides, change and movement were really just illusions, because if a thing became another thing, then it would mean that the original thing is not anymore. Like, if you become an adult, you are not a child anymore. And this, according to Parmenides, was impossible, because it's impossible for that which is to not be. Parmenides was kind of difficult to understand and very abstract, but he definitely was very influential. Most of the classical philosophers that came after Parmenides have to wrestle with his philosophy in some way. They have to justify that movement and change and difference are indeed possible. Some folks came up with the theory of elements to justify this: earth, water, air, and fire. You probably have heard of this one because it went on to be very influential during medieval times, and so it kind of stuck around in the culture. And since we're all thinking it, yes, the comic was better. That was one way to solve this philosophical challenge. Like, yes, nature is made of the same things that is never changing, in this case, the elements, but it is also made of different things, because these elements are combined and taken apart in different ways. The solution of the atomists was a bit more sophisticated. They said, if we keep dividing objects in half, at some point we will arrive at an object that is so small that it cannot be divided any further. They called this object
atomon, meaning indivisible.
If they cannot be separated any further, these atoma must therefore be the fundamental blocks of nature. So instead of one unified that which is, they theorized many tiny entities that created nature. And this was actually a significant departure from Parmenides' philosophy. Democritus rejected Parmenides' belief that change is an illusion. Democritus thought, and the atomists after him, that change was real. Or, at the very least, he believed that if change is not real, then the illusion of change is really realistic and it has to be explained. He therefore supported the concept of void, to canon, and stated that the universe was made of a lot of tiny entities that move around in the void. There are some subtle differences between the authors, but all atomists pretty much agree on how atoms are. Atoms cannot be divided, by definition. They are unchanging. They cannot be destroyed or created. We call them eternal. They cannot be made to change a shape. They are invisible to the human eye. They are infinite in number. They are all made of the same substance, and they each have a unique shape. That's right, for classical atomists, each atom has its own unique shape. This is an important difference between atomism in the classical world and our modern and contemporary atomic theory. We have found that there are a finite amount of types of atoms, particles, whatever. And particles of the same type are perfectly interchangeable in our theory. There's a whole philosophical debate about it, but for most intents and purposes, two atoms of hydrogen, for example, are pretty much the same particle, just in different places in the universe. But classical atomists thought about atoms more like snowflakes or grains of sand, each one with its own unique shape. So, The world is full of atoms, an almost infinite number of them going around. Great. How do they actually create the world? The ancient Greeks had no idea about electromagnetism or any of the other forces that keep atoms together. Physicists would call these fundamental forces. So their explanations for the world were purely mechanical. In their mind, there's all these atoms, each one uniquely shaped, and they're all swirling around and moving around all the time. So at some point, an atom that is shaped like a hook will meet an atom that is shaped like a hole, and they will stick together and attach. And then other atoms will also stick together to them and attach to them, giving birth to all things. So the origin of the world is this primordial vortex, this original cosmic swirling around of things. Leucippus, he's the first guy in our timeline, described the vortex as neither having up nor down, similar to dust particles floating around in the air under a sunbeam. And in this chaos, heavier atoms move towards the center of the vortex, and eventually they form the Earth, while lighter ones move to the perimeter, eventually forming all the celestial bodies. So in their vision, the Earth is at the center of the universe, and also flat for some fucking reason, go off, King, and made of the heaviest stuff, and celestial bodies are made of the lighter stuff. Epicurus then elaborates on this theory a little bit and tries to give an explanation for this primordial vortex. He comes up with the swerve, clinamen in Latin, parenklesis in Greek, all incredible names for a band if you ask me. Epicurus's most famous fan was a Latin poet named Lucretius, who wrote a beautiful poem called the Rerum Natura, where he describes the philosophy of his master. In book 2, Lucretius talks about the swerve and says,
"When bodies are carried downwards straight through the void by their own weight, at an uncertain time and in uncertain places, they swerve a bit in space. Just so much that you can say their motion has changed."
The swerve is a small and random deviation from a straight line, which makes atoms collide into each other and lock together. Philosopher Michel Serres notes in his book The Origin of Physics that Epicurus's explanation for the swerve doesn't make much sense if we think of it in terms of objects falling down, because obviously those tend to follow a straight line. But if we think of it as a flow, the metaphor makes much more sense. So for example, think of how when there's little wind, the smoke from a cigarette goes straight up in the beginning, and then at some point, seemingly random, it starts to swerve and create a series of vortices. Why does that happen? Well, because the particles of smoke all move straight up, all in lines that are parallel to each other, and then at some point, either because there's like maybe a wisp of wind or something like that, one of them deviates towards the other ever so slightly, and so they start all bumping into each other, and this creates the vortices. In physics, we say that the flow goes from laminar to turbulent, and Michel Serres says that Epicurean atoms are like that, but downwards. So they kind of all fall in parallel line, and then one of them bumps into the other, and they start swirling around. This is the kind of smart-ass thing that ChatGPT won't tell you, alright? The glorified plagiarizing machine should start listening to more competent people, if you ask me. And by the way, the atomic swerve is also the biggest difference between Epicurus and the atomists that came before him. It's considered Epicurus's most important original contribution. So, we have atoms, and then one of them deviates a little bit and bumps into another, and then they all create a big vortex, and then they get hooked into each other, and they create the world. Great. A question arises, why does one atom suddenly shift from its course? But the answer is just, because it has to be like that. Atomists didn't provide any further explanation, not really. For example, in his letter to Herodotus, Epicurus himself writes,
"But if it were not the case that by the smallest amount the swerve aside, all things would fall likewise straight downward in the void by their weight, like drops of rain, and there would be no interlocking at all, not any impact that would cause it, nor would anything ever come to be of the things that now exist."
Oh my god, I had so much fun translating these passages. I'm so nostalgic. It's like I'm in high school again, but this time without the suicidal ideation. Bertrand Russell, in his The History of Western Philosophy, points out that
all causal explanations must have an arbitrary beginning. This is why it is no defect in the theory of the atomists to have left the original movements of the atoms unaccounted for.
The atomists were kind of unique in the ancient world, because their explanations for the world had nothing to do with gods or spirits or myths or elements. They were far from the scientific method as we think of it today, but they were very materialist and reductionist in their explanations. They were very focused on the real world that exists in front of their eyes. And this was an original thought in the ancient world. There is no entity that organizes the universe, it just came to be like this by random chance. The world of the atomists is made of material particles that move around, and everything else is just our perception. So everything was a explained with the shapes of atoms. For example, bitterness, like the taste, was thought to be caused by angular and sharp atoms that would puncture the palate. And sweetness was caused by rounder and smoother atoms that slid easily across the tongue. The soul was made of atoms too, thought to be perfectly round and very light. They thought that breathing was the act of taking in new soul atoms and breathing out old soul atoms. And death is the last breath, when soul atoms stop being replenished. And by the way, remember that in the ancient world, they didn't necessarily believe that the mind was stored in the brain, like we do today. They thought that consciousness, which is the same as the soul, the mind, we're always talking about the same stuff, was stored in the gut, in the heart, maybe in the chest where the breathing happens. The identification of I with my head is actually a relatively recent concept in the history of Western culture. And just like color or texture or flavor are caused by different arrangements of atoms on the tongue or on the skin, atomists also believed that abstract concepts like justice or wisdom or happiness are also produced by different arrangements of soul atoms. It's obviously a completely unscientific theory by today's standard, but you gotta admit, it's really charming, it's just fascinating. This view of the soul was original for the time and completely opposite to our Judeo-Christian view of the soul. Because for the Christian doctrine, the soul is a sort of ghost that temporarily inhabits the body and, most importantly, that will live on once the body dies. Well, for atomists, since the soul too is made of atoms, it cannot exist anymore once the body has died. So it's a much more materialist and concrete view of the soul, which also implies a much more mature, in my opinion, view of death. For atomists, the idea of a life after death didn't make any sense. The atoms that make up the soul will disperse after the last breath, just like all the other atoms that make up our body. This is bleak, but very poetic, in my opinion. I remember when, you know, I studied these philosophers right at the beginning of high school, and then a few years into high school, my grandma died after almost 2 years of degenerating physical and mental activity. And I remember that even if I knew, of course, that this has no scientific basis, the idea that her soul is made of atoms that have dispersed made somehow a lot of sense to me, because she has been losing brain activity for a long time before her death, and it really felt like she had been losing herself, she had been losing her soul one beat at a time. I was obviously asking myself a lot of questions about what it means to die and what it means to have a soul, and frankly, Catholicism, the religion that I grew up with, was not bringing me any answers. Because of course it wasn't, it's Catholicism. But the idea that atoms of the soul are slowly exhaled, I don't know, I thought it was an interesting metaphor, you know? I've always felt more drawn to more materialist view of the soul. It's just kind of like a part of my own personal philosophy, ontology, whatever you want to call it. Democritus thought that because there are infinite atoms, they could also form a completely different world. In fact, he thought there could be infinite possible worlds out there, all different from our, and all created at random by the same atoms. And Epicurus famously said that the gods do exist, but they live far away, in between the possible worlds, and they are not concerned with what humans do. He saw gods and religions as a superstition, a way for the masses to explain what they didn't know. Can you guess which very popular modern philosopher really liked this guy? Epicurus preached a modest existence based on friendship and the simple pleasures of life. It's kind of ironic that his most famous student, Lucretius, the guy who wrote the big Latin poem that I mentioned before, ended up dying of suicide. Apparently the simple pleasures were not enough for him. Turns out that philosophy is not enough to find happiness. In life, you need to do hard drugs and date mentally unwell women who will ruin your life. Hey, I am classroom appropriate, okay? It's not my fault if your teacher is a coward. Determinism is the philosophical view that everything in the world has a causal explanation. Everything happens for a reason, a material and predictable reason, and therefore everything that will happen in the future is already determined by the conditions of the present. For example, the only fragment that we have of Leucippus goes,
"Nothing happens at random, but everything for a reason and by necessity."
But that brings up the question, if that is the case, why did these philosophers bother to write about ethics or aesthetic? If everything is determined by the atoms, and the future is already written in the way the atoms behave, shouldn't those things also be useless and just another illusion? Well, there's nuance to this. The atomists did believe that everything was caused by the movement of atoms, and they did believe that it was determined in advance. But they still believed in the value of free will, because to them, the movement of atoms was impossible to see or predict or understand. When Epicurus says that atoms are so tiny as to be invisible to the human eye, he means that, literally, but also, more broadly, in a metaphorical way. Atoms, according to these classical philosophers, were, yes, impossible to see, but also, more generally, impossible to investigate, impossible to witness, impossible to experiment on in any way. They were not interested in testing their theories. And so, they still thought that there was value in choosing what you want to do. Often, when philosophers of science talk about classical atomists, they stress the similarities between ancient theories and modern discoveries, in physics and chemistry, usually. For example, Goodreads informs me that Carl Sagan, the famous science communicator, in his book The Varieties of Scientific Experience, said,
"And were the vision of Democritus to have been adopted by Western civilization, instead of being cast aside for the pale views of Plato and Aristotle, we would be vastly further ahead today."
Damn. There definitely is a lot going on in their theories that resembles modern science. For example, their idea that in their primordial vortex, atoms that are heavier fall to the center, and that's how they get together. That is remarkably similar to our theories of star formation. The idea that the world is made of fundamental particles that cannot be divided is an assumption that has guided most of modern and contemporary physics. Like, we've been trying to smash particles into each other for more than half a century now, mostly because we want to see if we can find the fundamental ones. And more generally, even just the "you don't need God to explain the world" vibe that these philosophers had is one of the most basic assumptions of the modern scientific method. So they definitely innovated a lot in the ancient world, and they foreshadowed a lot of modern ideas. But ultimately, it's important to not overplay their influence on modern theories. There's a lot of YouTube videos on the subject that frame atomists as these visionaries, you know, who understood our modern scientific theories before us. And like, no, guys, because it's always guys, Democritus didn't predict the many worlds theory. They didn't predict modern science. Like, I'm not even sure that modern science is something that can be predicted in the first place. There are not multiple universes outside ours, that's not how anything works. You need to read the actual author before you make a video about it. You can't just come to this platform with a Wikipedia page and a dream. The ancient atomists were correct, but in the same way that a broken clock is correct twice a day. They were not doing science as we intend it today because they almost never employed the scientific method, which is a constant dialogue between theory and experiment. They were a step ahead of myths, but they were still much closer culturally to myths than to our modern scientific methods. Ultimately, they were just yapping. Like, it's hard to overstate how much ancient philosophers were just saying things. For example, the objections that Aristotle, yes, that Aristotle, was moving against the atomists were stuff like, if everything is made of atoms and the void between atoms exists, then shouldn't the void be made of atoms too? It was like watching two very stoned people try to have a debate about ontology. It's basically just the Joe Rogan experience. And even more modern chemists who are credited for having revived atomic theory, like Robert Boyle, for example, these people were actually mostly inspired by medieval science, which was, in the field of chemistry, mostly evolved from alchemy, which was mostly inspired by Aristotle's philosophy, actually. The theory of atoms that we use today is fundamentally different from what Democritus or Epicurus or whoever else said, because we now know about electromagnetism and other forces keeping particles together, and the ancient world had absolutely no clue about this. But you know what? That's okay. I noticed that when we deal with pre-scientific theories, there's always the temptation to evaluate them in comparison to modern theories. So either classical philosophers were geniuses with incredible foresight that were right all along, or they were misguided primitives getting in the way of real progress. And neither of these narratives actually gets through the heart of what's going on. Because I think this theory is fascinating in itself, even if it doesn't have a lot of scientific merit. I understand why people have the temptation to view antiquity through the lens of modernity, but in my opinion, it also usually ends up being the most boring framework, and it strips history of its most interesting parts. So yeah, I thought this theory was interesting and I wanted to make a video about it. I don't have a strong conclusion. I'll see you next time.